smells like a greenhouse in here, which is a lot better than what it smelled like when I was setting up all the plants earlier. It smelled like tacos and cigars. And I don't really mind the smell of cigars, even though I'm not a smoker. I don't mind the smell of cigars, and I really like the smell of tacos. And I don't know if I've mentioned this before, but I'm about to gross you out, because I figure if I'm going to creep myself out, I might as well creep out my friends. I was down here arranging all these plants for this filming, because it normally doesn't look like this. Normally these plants are up by the light, but when I film, I like to have them all around me, kind of like my audience. But I was in here and I was moving the plants around, and Rascal likes to come down here to keep an eye on me and make sure I'm not eating something that he should be eating. And he's sitting right here and he watches me. It's the weirdest thing. He's not curious about what's going on. He just sits there, and every time I turn around, I look around and I go, "What are you doing?" And his ears are up and he's staring right at me. I am very fascinating to this dog, and I'm flattered. But I'm working around these plants, and it smells like tacos and cigars. And I know that smell. I know that smell. That's Rascal's butt. When Rascal has, I mean, all dogs, if you have a dog, you know that dogs have gas problems every now and then. I really don't know if cats do, but I know dogs do. And I've had Great Danes. I've had big honking Great Danes. I've had little dogs. And they all have their own particular aroma. And Rascal's just happens to be cigars and tacos. It's a combined smell. And every time I smell that, it grosses me out, because I know it's coming from him. And so I smell the smell. And I thought, ooh. And he's making this sound at me. He's going, and that means he needs to go to the bathroom really, really bad. Mike calls it his teeth are floating. Basically, he had to go to the bathroom really, really bad, but he doesn't know how to tell me because he won't bark. So we go running to the door, and it's 7 degrees outside today. Yes, a balmy 7 degrees, not 70, 7, single digit. And that's the high for today. So he goes running out, and it's colder than heck. So he goes running out, and he immediately assumes the position, and he goes to the bathroom. And the poor thing, it's so cold, he can't relax. So I know, I'm telling you a story about a dog pooping. Well, anyway, it gets stuck onto his butt because it's so cold out there. So he comes running inside, and like a good daddy, I'm there with paper towels holding a dog like this with his butt in my face, trying to clean off his butt. But all I really wanted to do was come down here and film my episode, but I had to clean a dog's butt. But that's what we do because we love them, right? Anyway, I have some questions right here, because on two weeks ago, weekend edition, we did it out in the coop, and that was fun. I'll never do it again because they eat the questions, and I seriously wanted to get your questions answered. I think I might have missed a couple, but I do have other questions that you posted in the comment section, so I'm going to go ahead and do those really quick, because I want to go upstairs and I'm going to be filming an episode on treats that I make, because it comes back to the balance that I'm always talking about in my life and in my gardening. Whenever I tend to go off balance, bad things tend to happen. Whether it's in my mental state, whether it's in my physical state, whether it's in gardening, whenever something is off balance, you see that something goes wrong. You've seen the voodoo garden down here, and one time the voodoo garden looked like it was just decimated. That's because there was an imbalance in my soil, and I had to correct that. Well, I went to the doctor not too long ago, and I found out there was an imbalance in my health. And so I'm changing my diet, and I think some of you that are into healthy diets are gonna like this. I have to change my diet because my cholesterol is a little bit high, because I'm just like anybody else. I tend to eat bad things, and I'm a regular person. I'm not some kind of health guru. I'm not John Kohler. I'm not a raw vegan. So I don't eat everything that I should eat that's healthy for me. Sometimes I'm a little bad, and sometimes I have things that I shouldn't eat, but I try to make the balance with eating things that are good for me. Well, in the winter time, I don't have those fresh vegetables and fruits that I normally eat in the summer. Kind of weird. I eat a lot of fresh fruits and vegetables in the summer, and in the winter I tend to hibernate. I sleep more, I play video games, and I tend to snack on things that aren't really that good for me. Well, it caught up with me, and my cholesterol is just a little bit higher than it's supposed to be. It's at 221. And the doctor said, well, you should eat, all you really need to do, you don't need to do any kind of weird medications or anything like that. All you really need to do is up the fiber in your diet. And we started talking about what's high in fiber. And it turns out it's a fun, easy diet to do. So I'm gonna do that. I'm gonna see, I was getting to something. I'm gonna go upstairs, I'm gonna whip stuff up, but It's not going to be a big old bowl of bran that you shove in your face and you cry all day. No. Eating a little bit healthier can mean eating stuff that isn't quite so good for you, but also eating more things that are good for you. So I kind of change the balance a little bit so that I can find my constant balance. You see what I mean? So some of the things I'm going to make in the kitchen on next week's episode, if you're looking for something that's 100% crazy healthy, you're not going to find it. So you may just want to skip that. But it's going to be healthy enough to where it offsets the unhealthy things enough to help me get back to my health balance and my cholesterol lowering a little bit. It's going to be fun and it's going to be delicious too. So stay tuned for that. So for right now, I'm going to do a weekend edition and I'm going to answer your gardening questions because, you know, that's what I do. That's how I roll. And I'm going to, for those of you who aren't familiar with Weekend Edition, is where you post your questions in the comment section below this video. I answer the questions off the cuff, right off the top of my head. I don't go around looking for the best answer, the perfect answer. So some of the answers that I give may not be to your liking and they may not even make sense, but it comes from my head and that's the best place that I can possibly find an answer for you. Okay. First one, I'll get to this one. First one is from Debbie Thomas. And, oh, by the way, hi, Demi. Kumquats. Okay. Kumquats. I started them from seed. They get to the second or third set of leaves, and then the leaves start to wilt. New leaves curl. I transplanted them twice. Once they had wet feet. Reduced the amount of watering. Fed them both 16-16-16 with micronutrients and regular flower veggie fertilizer. They're alive but struggling. Help. From what I've pre-read this before I came on, so that I have to change the wording because sometimes people write differently than they talk. So I have to word this so that it makes sense to me. Anyway, Debbie and everybody else who grows plants, not just necessarily kumquats, from just looking at your question, I see some things that you might be doing wrong. First of all, you mentioned that you had to transplant them twice. Okay, these are plants that you just planted and they're just starting to grow and you transplanted them twice. Well, if they're young plants, they don't need to be transplanted twice. Start them off in a small container, and I do that as well. I don't have any right near me, but you know, I start them off in the little cups. Then when they get bigger, I transplant them into a bigger pot, but I want to make sure that that pot is big enough for the roots to grow for a while, because each time you transplant something, it has a risk of going through shock or transplant shock period. My tomatoes do that every now and then too, and they'll just stop growing and throw a little hissy fit because their roots get a little damaged, because this is not natural for plants. Plants do not naturally get transplanted. So once they're in soil, they stay in soil. You transplanted them twice. I would recommend that when you plant your seeds, if they're that fast growing and that you have to transplant them two times, you might want to start out in a bigger pot. Rich, well-drained soil. That is the key. That is the key to just about everything that you're going to grow. Make sure that soil is well-drained, because farther down you mentioned it had wet feet. And wet feet, for those of you who don't know what that means that the soil is very, very wet and the roots basically start drowning in water. Yes, they drown in water because roots, even though they're in the soil here, they need oxygen and they need water, but they need that balance that I'm always screaming about. They need water, the water needs to go away, and then oxygen comes back into the soil, gives them oxygen. Then you give them water, then they get oxygen. It's an alternating cycle and it's very healthy for roots. And yes, oxygen does go down into the soil. So I think you've been watering them just a little bit too much. You might want to just lay off that watering can. Whenever you get tempted, walk away, okay? Walk away, Debbie. Don't water them so much, because so many of us, we want to really care for our plants, and that's a good thing. But we tend to overfeed them and overwater them and overcare for them and basically love them to death. So you may want to just lay off the water a little bit, let the soil dry out. What I recommend to people is get the feel of your pot. You can feel when it's watered, when it's heavy. When you first water it and it's thoroughly watered, feel it. Go, okay, it feels like that. Then when it's bone dry, pick it up and feel it. You'll get to know the feel of the pots. Wait until it's really dry and then water it again. That way you're giving the roots time to dry out. And also when they dry out, something spurs in their little root brains and they say, ooh, no water, gotta grow. And they do, they start growing more. And then you water them, it relieves the the need to grow, feeds the plant, and then they relax for a minute, and then when they dry out, they start growing again. That's the key to a healthy root system, okay? So, and also, you're feeding them fertilizer. When they're very young, they don't need a whole lot of fertilizer. Lay off that fertilizer just a little bit, okay? Maybe whatever you're fertilizing, cut it in half or cut it in fourths. And give them just a little bit of fertilizer. A little bit goes a long way, especially when it's 16, 16, 16. That's nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. 16, 16, 16 sounds like inorganic because organic fertilizers generally don't go that high. Inorganic fertilizers such as Miracle-Gro, those feed the plant directly. They don't feed the soil. So when you're giving them a lot of fertilizer like that, you're basically shoving a hot dog down a baby's throat. You gotta lay off, okay? Give them just a little bit of food. Maybe cut that down by a fourth, into a fourth, and then you're gonna be just fine, okay? And I think that should do you. All right, next one, Ruth Williamson. Hi, Ruth. Thank you for answering questions. My pleasure. I really do enjoy this. Anyway, she goes on to say, I have a question. Can you make a video showing how to use the homemade tomato seed mats that you made using the tomato seeds you saved in one of your old videos? I followed your instructions last fall and made some tomato seed mats on paper towels, but now I'm sort of panicking on how to use them since I've never used one before. Now, I had to look at this question for quite a while. I was thinking, seed mats, what is this thing that she calls seed mats? I have no idea. I thought it was the heating pad that I used for my seeds, and it turns out I don't think it's the heating pad, because she mentioned tomato seeds. And a couple years ago, I showed people how to, the two best methods for saving tomato seeds, and it was really a good episode. One method was to ferment the seeds in water and then pour off the water and then dry out the seeds. The other method is, if you don't have that many seeds, you just take a tomato and squeeze it and rub it on a paper towel, put it in the window and let it dry on a paper towel. And then you have all these seeds dotting this paper towel, and when it comes to time to plant, you just tear a little square with a seed and you plant it in soil. And so I really don't need to do an episode on that. I'm just going to explain it, because this will definitely help you out. You take a small container, and I don't know why I keep reaching for this tomato, probably because it smells good and I'm drawn to tomato smells. What you want to do is you want to take a small container, like a small plastic cup, put soil in it, but keep it about maybe a half an inch from the surface. You tear off a square of that paper towel with a seed on it, or two seeds on it. You place it on the soil, then cover it up with about a quarter inch to a half inch of soil, tap it down gently, and then water it gently. The reason I use the paper towels for the seeds is pretty cool. The paper towel holds the seed. You plant a little square of paper towel with the seed on it. Don't worry about it screwing up the seed. It won't. What's going to happen is that paper towel is holding onto the seed, and this is where it gets really fun. And you water it with the soil on top. The water goes down, and sometimes your soil seems to repel water. You know what I'm talking about? Well, when you have the paper towel holding onto the seed, when the water gets down there, you know how paper towels just go and they soak up the water really fast? That's what they're designed to do. Well, what's going to happen is when the water touches that paper towel, it's going to soak the water up, draw it to that seed, and hold it in that area and keep the seed moist a lot longer than soil would do that. And then when the seed sprouts, the root pushes through the paper towel. The paper towel is very soft. It'll push through that. The paper towel is going to rot away, no problem at all. And the root is going to go down. The top is going to come up. It's going to be perfect. And so that works really well when you're doing the paper towel method. That's what I'm assuming you mean by seed mat. So you just take it off, pop it in the soil. You can do this with pepper seeds, tomato seeds, any kind of seed. It holds it really well, and it's a good idea. Anyway, I don't have to do an episode on that because I just explained it. It's very easy to do, and Ruth, don't worry about it. Just take it, toss it in the soil. Nature's going to find a way to get that seed to sprout. Next one, black stack tube. I just love these names. Black stack tube asks, I live in a condo and I garden on a balcony. That's a common thing too. I've had a lot of people tell me about balcony gardening. I can't get rid of the old soil easily and get new soil. How do I build up the soil to make it fertile again without chemicals and needing a lot of space to do it? No composting can be done on my balcony. That's a very good question. And I'm going to give you the best answer I possibly can. All right? This is how I see it. If I lived in an apartment and had a balcony and I was growing on a balcony, here's what I would do. Your old soil does get used up. If you grow plants in the same soil year after year, that soil is going to get very empty. I use an organic fertilizer which feeds the soil, which feeds the plant, so it keeps recharging it. But sometimes you just need to change that soil, or if you're using inorganic fertilizers like Miracle-Gro, that soil is going to empty out really, really fast. So what I would recommend doing is you don't have to make compost. You don't have to do any of that stuff. You don't even have to throw the soil out. All you need to do is get yourself a container like a 5-gallon bucket and go to the store, Home Depot, Lowe's, Walmart, a gardening center, and look for bagged composted manure, okay? That is the one thing that is going to do the best for you. Bagged compost, it's okay, but it's not as potent as bagged composted manure. And bagged composted manure doesn't stink, so you don't have to worry about it stinking. And you can toss it in that bucket, throw a rag over it to keep the flies out of it and stuff. It's going to be relatively moist, but when you throw the towel over it, it'll allow it to dry out, and then you can just save it there forever. And then you take this, and you take a container, maybe another bucket, you take the soil, you mix it in with a manure, probably about 1/4 manure, composted manure, and no, it doesn't look like manure, it looks like black dirt. Mix it in about 1/4 composted manure with 3/4 of your soil. Mix it up together, pop it in a container, use an organic fertilizer, liquid fertilizer, and there's a kind that I'm going to be getting, and I'm not going to recommend it just yet, okay? I want to test it out, and then when I do test it out, if it works for me, I'm going to recommend it for you, okay? But for right now, get yourself a liquid organic fertilizer, mix it with your water, and that combined with your composted manure in your soil is going to rejuvenate your soil and give it a whole new life. It's going to be beautiful, and you're going to love it, and you don't have to throw anything out. Okay? I hope that works out well for you, and stay tuned in future episodes. Probably the end of this month, I'm going to order my liquid organic fertilizer, test it out, and if it does what I hope it does, I'm going to recommend it to you. I think it's going to work really well. Next one, Abby Kilpatrick. Hi, Abby. What do you know about air pruning, and have you ever tried it? What are your thoughts on it? That is a question that I've gotten more than once, air pruning, and I'm just going to give it to you straight, okay? I don't do it. I don't do it because it's not that it's a bad system. There are a lot of good systems out there, but I can't do everything and I don't want to do everything. I find my niche, my groove, and I do it my way, and that's how I do things. So just because I don't practice a method doesn't mean it's not a good method. Air pruning, for those of you who don't know what it is very, very simple. I'm going to grab my little prop here again. There are things called grow bags and cloth growing containers, and they are porous. And there's also plastic ones that have holes on the side. You may wonder, why would they have that? Well, the theory and the practice is when you plant something, the roots are, and this is mainly for potted gardens, okay? This has nothing to do with gardening outside. But for potted plants, the roots are going to go out, they're going to hit the side of the pot, and they're going to go down, and then when they hit the bottom, they're going to go around, and it forms this wall of roots. You've seen this if you've grown plants before in containers. You pop it out and it's root bound. It's a wall of roots. And then you transplant it into a bigger pot. You think, ah, you poor thing. You put it into a larger pot, you put it in good soil, and then the plant doesn't do so well. And then you take it out and you realize that wall of roots is still there. Yeah, it's happened to a lot of us. It's happened to me quite a bit. And that's because it's root bound. And sometimes when they're root bound, they will not send out roots out from the side. So what happens is, some pots have this mesh on the bottom and or the sides. And what happens is plants have two different kinds of roots. This is in a nutshell, okay? It's not scientific. They have two different kinds of roots. The main feeder roots that go out and down. Then they have the hair roots that come off of the bigger roots. Well, the big roots, they go out. They need to get out there, get down. They go really, really deep generally and far out in order to get the good stuff. The water, the nutrients, all that fun stuff. Then they start sending out little fine hairs. Those are the little helpers. And they absorb stuff as well. But these plants are not designed to be in pots. I mean, let's face it, this is not a natural environment for them. So these roots go out, they hit the side of the pots. In the air pruning pots, what they'll do is they'll go out of the pots. They actually grow out of the pots through the little holes. And then when these roots hit the air, they're like, oh, and they die. I know that sounds sad, but they do. It's called burning them off. And the roots will go out, and when roots hit air, they die. They're not designed to be in air. They're designed to be in a moist soil environment. So the big root goes out, it dies, not the whole root, just where it hits the air. And then the rest of the root that's in the pot, it's weird. Plants have this weird rudimentary intelligence. The root tells the plant, hey, the end of it died. Okay, and so the plant says, well, send out more roots from what's still living. So the what's left of the root will send out more roots inside the pot. And then if those go to the outside, the tips of them die, and the plant does the same thing. So exponentially, the pot will fill on the inside with roots, and they won't wrap around each other quite so much. Not a bad thing, but I prefer not to do that. What I do is I just when I check my plants periodically. I check them, make sure that when the roots start showing on the sides, I put them into a bigger pot, and that way they can go out farther. Because this is my belief. I believe that I'm going to get a much better product if I put them into larger and larger pots until finally they can't reach the side. That way they have maximum amount of soil in order for their roots to go out. And I don't have to worry about them like air pruning, because even with air pruning, eventually that pot is going to fill up with roots, because it's like a pyramid effect. Root goes out, dies at the tip, puts out a half a dozen root hairs, those go out, they reach, it's just going to keep going and going. And from what I understand, it's not going to last forever. It's a good short-term fix, but I don't believe that it's the best thing to go for long-term. Long-term, bigger pots. That's how I go. But I'm not saying it's a bad system, so if you want to try it, give it a go. Okay, let's see. Penny Treasures. I like Penny Treasures. I've seen her posts for many, many years. She's been a subscriber for a long time. Penny asks, now that you have many more animals in the coop, do you clean it in the winter? No, I never clean my coop in the winter, and I do that for one reason. Here's how I work the things in the coop. I throw down either wood shavings or straw, bales of straw, or dried grass that I mow out, or dried leaves. Anything dry and carbon type things, like dried grass, hay, straw, leaves, those are the browns that are in compost. And then the greens that are in compost, browns and greens, the greens are the nitrogen-rich things, like manure, urine, things like that. Well, I supply the carbon, and I throw in a thick layer of that in the coop. It keeps the birds' feet warm in the winter, gives them something to scratch around in, and it catches the poop. Okay, so the poop doesn't just pile up into this big, thick cake of poop. I don't want that. And they scratch around, they mix it all up, and then throughout the winter, I keep throwing in more and more. Like maybe once a week, once every 2 weeks, I throw in some more. And then they poop on that, they scratch it around. In the springtime, I have this nice, thick, around a 6-inch layer of a mixture of poop and straw. So it's greens and browns. It doesn't start composting because it's too cold in there and it's not piled up high enough. So then in the spring, I let the birds out one day. I close off the coop. They go out and they do their thing and peck at bugs and stuff. I go in there with a wheelbarrow and I pull it all out there in early spring. As soon as all chance of freezing is gone, I clean it out when it's nice and cold outside. And then I pile up and I get this huge, huge mountain of manure and straw, and boy does it stink. It starts composting, steaming like a son of a gun, and I get the compost done before planting time. So I have all my compost already made and done. And by the way, when I clean out the coop, I hurry up and fill it up with just a little bit more straw and hay and stuff. But also in the spring, the birds aren't in the coop as much, so they're pooping outside, so they don't make as much manure on the inside. So I throw in a little bit of straw and dried stuff to keep them comfortable and to catch the poop so they don't walk around their own poop as much. But I use the other stuff to make my compost, and then I put it around my trees and in my garden. I'll be demonstrating that this year, but no. I never clean out during the winter because it's all frozen hard, it's solid, and plus I can't open up the door to get the wheelbarrow out and stuff because the animals keep trying to get out. So I do that only one time, well actually two times, one in the early spring and one in the late fall. That's when I do it. Okay, next one, Sandra Citelli, did I say that right? Okay, it's got to be Sandra Citelli. I hate to mispronounce things, but you know me, I butcher the language. Sandra asks, I have a question for you. My tomato plant is in full fruiting mode, but they're green. It's January. How can I save my harvest? Thank you. Well, I don't know where you live where your tomatoes are grown in January, but boy, am I jealous of you. More than likely, you're living down south. Well, if it's getting too cold for your tomatoes, tomato plants and tomatoes will not handle a frost unless you cover them up. And that's when the temperature gets down into the low 30s and stuff. When that happens to me, what I do is I pick all the tomatoes. Green, yellow, red, it doesn't matter. Tomatoes, it's done. garden time is done, when there's going to be a frost, I could cover up my plants, but I hate to play that because a little wind will blow them over and then I got to put the thing back over them. I just figure, yeah, you know what? I had a good run. Time to take them off. You can pick green tomatoes, place them on a counter out of the sunlight anywhere in your house at room temperature, and they will ripen. Trust me, I figure about maybe 80 to 90% of them will naturally ripen on your counter. Don't have to put an onion in there or an apple or put them in a bag, none of that garbage. Just put them on a counter, set them off to the side, and they will ripen and you can use them that way. That's how you do it. That's a very simple question. I appreciate the simple questions every now and then so I don't have to overwork my brain. Tom from the Black Hills of South Dakota. Tom asks, how many square feet is the Voodoo Garden and how many bulbs do you have? He means light bulbs. Are they all hung from the ceiling? I want to turn one of our lower level rooms into a grow room and I need some ideas. Well, I'm going to do you a very special favor, Tom. I'm going to grab the camera and I'm going to show you exactly what the Voodoo Garden's made of. Okay. One thing you all don't know is that I have this little closet underneath the stairs, and this is where I keep all the pots. I have a telescope, extra vermiculite, you know, just junk, and this is where I set the tripod in this closet. So that's where you're actually standing when I'm filming, in the closet. Okay, and from that closet, the view that you have is right here. Now let me go from the right. I'm going to do this nice and slow so that I don't make you seasick. Okay, here's the right wall. There's a shelf up there. And this wall here is approximately 10 feet long. This wall over here, I believe, is around 12 feet, give or take. And then there's a wall over here that of course is 10 feet. There's the door where I come into the Voodoo Garden. And here's the back wall and the lighting that I use for filming, and then my water for the plants. But this is all the Voodoo Garden is. It actually is not a very large room. And a friend came to visit and he walked in here. He goes, I thought it was bigger. Nope, it's actually a very small room. I wish I had a larger Voodoo Garden, but that's going to have to wait until I win the lottery. Here's the lighting, and I did an episode on how I installed it. When I first moved here, there was a fluorescent light fixture, a really crappy looking one, right here. And I took it out, and that's where the wiring comes out of the ceiling. I used all brand new wiring, and here's the light fixtures I use. There's a metal junction box at the top, that dark brown thing. You can buy those in the electrical section at Lowe's. And then there is a light fixture that screws right onto it. And I just wire it in to the main wiring, and it also splits off on the inside and goes to the next light. And that's how it works. All of the connections are inside the metal box, so it's perfectly safe, and they're screwed onto the studs of the ceiling. Now I have 8 bulbs that are running in here. Let's see, 10. Sorry, I lose track. There are 10 bulbs in here. Some of them have splitters, like this. Yeah, I know that looks kind of weird, but it's all screwed in nice and tight. And I do have extenders. These are weird. These are bendy little things that you can screw into the light fixture here, and it hangs straight down, but it also bends. It's like conduit. And then you can screw a bulb or screw another one in there and then hang it from the ceiling. This is how I can maneuver my lights all over the place, because I need more light right over here where I'm running the seedlings than I do for like the bigger plants. So some of these I don't even put lights into the sockets, because over here to the left I don't need any light because there's absolutely nothing underneath this. If I ever have to fill up the room, I can put more lights in here. And each one of these lights runs about 105 watts, and that's what it uses, 105 watts of power. And the incandescent equivalent is around, I think it's 500. Bet you didn't expect that, did you? And that's how I run it. I just run the bulbs along the ceiling, and that's how it works. And I maneuver the plants all over the place. They're always changing positions depending on what kind of light they need. Okay, next question. Don't worry, I'm almost done, folks. I know that this seems like a lot of questions, but I want to make sure I get your questions answered, because you actually took the time to ask these questions. And let's face it, I got nothing to do outside. It's winter time, it's 7 degrees, everything's frozen. I'm not gardening out there, so I have nothing better to do than to sit here and answer your questions. And hopefully this is going to help you in the next growing season. Unique Mission 480 asks, question! Okay. Have you ever had an aquaponics garden or plant? No. That's an easy question. People have asked me that before. Ray, why don't you do aquaponics or hydroponics? The difference as I see it is hydroponics is where you grow in water and you add the nutrients and stuff and there's no soil. Whereas that's hydroponics. Aquaponics is where you have fish or other kind of water creatures that provide the nitrogen from their poop or whatever they do in the water, and then you use that to fertilize your plants. It's kind of a symbiotic relationship, and then the fish can sometimes eat the plants. So that's a pretty cool thing as well. As a matter of fact, I wanted to promote it because it's an alternative to growing with soil where you don't have to deal with the soil. And I gave a small hydroponics kit away in a giveaway. Yeah, it was kind of fun. But I personally don't get into that because I'm a soil gardener. I have, for some reason, soil and I have this connection, and it's hard for me to explain. I have to touch the soil, I have to be with the soil, I have to have connection with the soil. I can't get that with aquaponics. It just doesn't light my fire. I tried to read up on it and try to get into it, and I just didn't. And then I stopped and I asked myself, why are you trying to do something that you really don't like? So I read about it. I understand the basics of it, but it's just not my thing. And it's a great alternative, and it's a fun way to grow. And there is a guy, and he grows in Australia, Rob Bob. And Rob Bob is one of the few channels that I am subscribed to. I don't subscribe to very many gardening channels because they really don't catch my interest. But Rob, and I'll put a link down here. Rob does aquaponics, and Rob does aquaponics really, really well. You know what's really cool about Rob is that he's not an expert. He's a do it. Oops, I messed this up. Let's try this. And then he tries this, and then he succeeds at this, and then he learns lessons, and he teaches through his experience. He does regular gardening. And he does the aquaponics outside. And it's a really fun thing to do. You can do aquaponics. You don't even have to do it inside. You can do it outside. And he shows how he does it. And he does things homemade. He doesn't buy all these fancy, expensive things. He does it homemade. And it's really kind of nice because in the wintertime, when those of us in the Northern Hemisphere can't be gardening, I tune into his channel and he's growing because he's down in the Southern Hemisphere. And then when I'm growing, I'm really not tuning into a whole lot of gardening channels because I'm busy doing my own thing. He's not growing, so he's tuning into my stuff. So it's really pretty cool. But yeah, he can answer questions that you would have so much easier than I could. And he also does it with an enthusiasm I couldn't do because it's not something that I enjoy as much. But I like his compost and stuff like that, so I tune into his channel. Next one is from Chevy6299, a subscriber from way back in the day. How are the cats doing in the cold temps you're having? Well, I just saw the cats this morning, as a matter of fact, when I was coming downstairs with the questions. And Black Kitty, there's an update, okay? Here's an update. Some of you may not like this, but this is life. Life isn't always the way that we want it to be. Black Kitty comes and goes, and that's the one. These are both strays that people dumped off and I took care of. And the gray kitty I call Special K. He's the little one that was, you know, the gray tabby. Well, Special Kitty, Special K, lives close by, and he's been going into the chicken coop and snuggling down on those bales of hay. So has Black Kitty. But Black Kitty, I don't know what happened to him. He disappeared for a couple weeks once. And this was back in the autumn. And I thought he died, because you never know with farm cats, because they don't come inside and you can't capture them because they're half wild, half tame. And Black Kitty didn't show up for a while, and I thought, wow, that's kind of sad, because we have coyotes that come around. I call them the Reds. That's from a gaming term. But the demons, as the coyotes are known around here, they came in really close this season. I thought, oh, they probably caught and ate the cat, and I felt kind of bad. But you know, that nature has a way of really disappointing us sometimes. But Black Kitty came back. And here's where it gets kind of funky, and you'll just have to understand that this is how life works. Black Kitty came back with one less eye. And I didn't know what happened, but it was all healed up. And I didn't know what was going on, and Black Kitty won't let me capture him to take him into the vet. You try to pick him up, and he will claw you to death. And so I did the very best that I could. I kept an eye on him, and if push came to shove, I would have to literally put him into a cage. But his eye was all healed up, and he was perfectly healthy, and everything was fine. Apparently, he got into a fight somewhere with something, and he lost an eye. So, he's a pirate. And it healed up. He is perfectly healthy. He's happy. Him and the gray kitty, and you know what's really a good thing from that? He doesn't leave the property anymore. I think he went out hunting and he found something that was a little bit bigger than he could handle. And so he learned a lesson. Maybe an owl got a hold of him. Maybe the coyotes got a hold of him. I don't know. But what I do know is that since then, he doesn't leave the property. And him and Great Kitty have bonded really, really close. And they stay in the coop now. And the turkeys and chickens don't mind. And they cuddle up on the hay and they stay warm in there and they take a bowl of food in there for them and they drink out of the chicken's water. So that's pretty cool. Anyway, last question. Last question on Weekend Edition is from Tom Lindgren. Tom asks, how many tom turkeys did you end up with? In the video, last video on the Weekend Edition, he said, it looks like three halfway strutting around and one being the obvious top turkey. Also, is the little white turkey hen just a mutation or is she a different breed? You know, that is a good question, and that is something that I haven't quite figured out. There is definitely one dominant tom turkey. You saw that. He's the one that goes, and he just sails around with his wings down, proud as can be. And at first when he started doing that, I thought, oh gosh, he's going to get aggressive and start beating me up, and I'm going to have to get rid of him. Well, he doesn't do that. He is a domestic Easter. He's called a bronze turkey, not broad-breasted bronze. Bronze. There's two different kinds of bronze turkeys. The broad-breasted bronze, which are the super, super fat ones, and normally you see those, the white ones, and they raise those for Thanksgiving. They don't live very long because they were bred to have huge breasts for turkey meat, and they don't stand on their legs very well, and they don't live very long. They're not supposed to live long because they were bred by man from wild turkeys to be fat, basically meat on legs. Well, these aren't those. These are regular bronze, so they don't get quite as fat. So, I ordered all these turkeys from the same company and they all arrived in one box and they all looked exactly alike. But as I grew older, I noticed that they didn't quite look alike. And I'm wondering if they're from different batches from different parts of this company, which I think is good because it's a more diverse genetics. He is a regular turkey and he started strutting really early when he was just a young turkey. It was kind of cute to see the little turkey putting his little wings out. I was like, I'm the boss. I'm the boss. And I'm like, no, you're not. You're a baby. So anyway, he grew up being the dominant turkey. Other turkeys started strutting as well. But turkey lingo is kind of weird. When you're strutting and the dominant turkey comes in, you put that strut away. You know, you don't do that around the turkey, or you're asking for trouble, because basically they're saying, look at me, I'm fit, I want to mate with the females, and you don't do that around the dominant turkey or he will kick your butt. So whenever they're strutting, he walks in the room, oop, feathers go down, and they act like nothing's happening. And here's another thing. This is weird. I'll bet a lot of you guys didn't know that. Female turkeys will sometimes strut as well. Yep. I had obvious female turkeys, and I know that they were female turkeys because eggs came out of their butt. So I know they were females. And this is when I lived in Bruno. And the female that was laying the eggs, she, for some reason, got it into her mind. I think I'm going to strut. And so she started strutting. The only thing is, it looks kind of like they half phoned it in, you know, it doesn't really look right. So I knew that that was a female. I really can't tell because they're not 100% full grown, which ones are males and which ones are females. Also, some have long legs, some of them have very short legs. Some of them are fatter, some of them are skinnier. A couple of the females, they're really small. They look like a big chicken and they're lighter colored. And I have no idea what's going on. I have a menagerie out there that just, I have no idea what's going on. So I really can't tell you. As far as I can tell, I can guarantee you I have 2 to 3 toms. And I hope that's all. Because when you have a lot of toms and not very, very many females, the turkey fights start. And they did start. A couple turkeys went at it really crazy. And you can't tell between males and females when they're fighting because females will fight just like males. They're all very, very grumpy birds, except when it comes to me. They kind of like me. So anyway, that's the best answer I can possibly give you, Tom. I hope that helps. But also, hopefully they're going to mate and lay eggs and I can get more turkeys out of the deal. That's going to be kind of cool having baby turkeys around here. But that pretty much wraps it up for Weekend Edition. Thank you everybody for your questions. If you do have any questions concerning indoor outdoor gardening, post them in the comment section below and I'll answer them the very best that I can. I may not always be right. It may not be the answer that you want, but it's going to be the best answer I can possibly give you. And that wraps it up. Thank you everybody. And I will see you next week upstairs. We're going to do something kind of good, kind of delicious, and kind of good for us. Until then, have a great day everybody. Bye. Ha ha!